Thank you, Tom. By the way, this picture is not from the Netherlands, but from England.
It's King Arthur, isn't it?
It's King Arthur, yes. And it's a round table. This one. Yeah. So thanks to ITF for inviting me to the round table. And I couldn't resist the temptation of including a slide on King Arthur's round table. But it's not what I'm going to talk about. This is what I'm going to talk about. I prepared this presentation together with my colleague at Significance, Marco Kouwenhoven. Marco also works at the Delft University of Technology, and I also work at the Institute for Transfer Studies, University of Leeds. So it's hard to avoid Leeds at the moment. Three topics: the productive use of travel time, the value of time, and the value of reliability. And all the results I'll be presenting are results from the Netherlands. The presentation consists of four blocks. In the first block, I'll present the three national value of travel time surveys. I abbreviate it as VTT, value of travel time, that we had so far in the Netherlands on passenger transport. We also had three surveys on freight transport, but that's another presentation today, passengers. I'll briefly discuss the methods that we used, the main results that we got from the latest survey, where the data collection took place in 2009 and 2011. And I'll give some new results that were not in our previous reports on the impact of the time and cost of the reference trip, topic we had before, on the value of travel time. Then in the second block, I'll talk about productive travel time. Are you working during the trip? And in all three surveys in the Netherlands so far, for business trips, we've used this Hensher equation, which, in our case, encompasses the use of willingness to pay. Then I'll extend the idea of productive travel time to useful travel time. So it's not just working that you can do during the trip. You might also watch a movie or talk to someone, read a book. That's useful travel time. And I also extend then from business trips to all purposes. And finally, I'll talk about changes of the value of travel time over the years. What have we found for the Netherlands so far, and then the question of this round table, will we ever get to a zero value of travel time? Well, we'll see. People who know me may know that I like to cite people, to put some citations in the presentation, and I still do. And here's one you might expect, maybe, from Oscar Wilde. He has a certain Lord Darlington in a play, and Lord Darlington asks, "What is a cynic?" And then he answers himself, "A cynic is a man who knows the price of everything and the value of nothing." Something to think about, but I won't give you time for that. And I take the risk of being regarded as a cynic by continuing on the value of time in the Netherlands, which Oscar Wilde probably would have called the price of time. So we had three surveys so far in the Netherlands. Data collection took place in 1988. 1997, and in 2009 and 2011. In the first survey, 88, the recruitment of the respondents took place en route. So while they were traveling, we met them at railway stations, bus stops, parking garages, petrol stations, and we asked them to participate in a mailback survey. So those were the days of paper and pencil interviews. We still did the same thing in 97. Also because we didn't want to change that much. But in 2009-2011, things had changed too much and we did something else. We recruited respondents by means of a commercial internet panel. And with the benefit of hindsight, that was a mistake. So don't try this at home. We got very low values of time from this. So if you want to have low values of time, this may be a way to do it. But we didn't believe it, what we got from that. People select themselves on the basis of a low value of time to be in a commercial internet panel, and it's a very selective thing that you get. So we went back to the original recruitment method en route, the en route recruitment, but we did the interviews online in 2011. And most of the results are based on what we did in 2011 in terms of data collection. Then the segments that we have, well, we have a segmentation by travel purpose, but also one by mode. in all surveys, we looked at car, train, and local public transport. We did a double binary SP experiment in 88 and 97. I mean that we have two alternatives and we have two attributes, only time and cost trading. Then in 2009 and 2011, the respondents first got to see some of these binary trade-offs, just time and cost. And then they got some other choice situations, which also included reliability, a specific representation of reliability, which I will show you later on. So the last survey that we did in the Netherlands was not just a value of time survey, it was a value of time and value of reliability survey. Some common characteristics of all the three studies that we did in the Netherlands, the national surveys, they all had the same objective, the same goal, which is to get values by mode and purpose. So not by distance band. In the Netherlands, we haven't had values of time by distance band. We only had values of time by mode and purpose, and at some stage also by income, but we gave that up. And we do this for cost-benefit analysis. It's not so much meant in the Netherlands for input into the modeling. It's meant for cost-benefit analysis. In cost-benefit analysis, you need values of time for a number of years. And for that, we use escalation factors to escalate the values for the reference year to other years on the basis of an income LSSD of the value of transport time. I'll tell you later which one. We realized from the start that just using an income LSSD may not properly capture all the structural changes that may take place in the value of time. And hence, there is the requirement to redo such a national survey regularly. And I put here, but this is based on what happened in practice, 10 years. It's not an official requirement, I think. It's just what happened about every 10 years we do this kind of national surveys. In all those surveys, we rely on willingness to pay of travelers, and we use within-mode SP experiments to elicit the preferences. The data are then used in discrete choice models that we that already in 88 included interaction terms for observed heterogeneity. So this means that, for instance, people with a different age class, with different income classes, got a different value of time. Only in the application later on, for cost-benefit analysis, we averaged it all together. In 2009-2011, on top of this thing with interaction terms, we included power law functions, so nonlinear functions, of the reference strip, time and cost. And we also estimated panel latent class models to cater for unobserved heterogeneity, which we had not used before. Then we used the Henschel equation all the time, every time. And the estimation results are expanded to national averages using the Dutch National Travel Survey. Quite similar, I think, to what happens in the UK. This is how the choices look like, and you can see that the top copy is really a copy from the original questionnaire, the paper and pencil questionnaire. Of course, it's in Dutch, it's original. Does this work? Yeah. Yeah, on the left-hand side, it says travel duration the same as now, and travel cost the same as now. So there's not really a reference value here. We just say it is what it is, and yeah, paper and pencil. We couldn't do anything more than that. And then on the right-hand side is a longer, and in this case, cheaper trip. That's what we did in 88 and 97. In 2009 and 2011, the binary experiment used absolute levels of travel time and travel cost, as you see here. And then all the people in 2009 and 2011 got to see some other choice situations which include reliability. Now, including reliability is for in an SP is not so easy, and we did a lot of piloting and thinking on how to do this. In the models, we wanted to have something like the standard deviation of travel time. You can't ask that in a survey. So we tried a number of things, and what worked best in these pilots was this format. It looks as follows. We have, again, two alternatives, A and B. There's the departure time, that's on the top there. And then we ask, or we say, you have an equal probability on each of the following five travel times and corresponding arrival times. and then you get 5 travel times and 5 arrival times. And then at the bottom, there's the usual travel time and the travel cost of these alternatives. This is how we presented it to the respondents, and this is on the basis for our reliability estimates. Now the main results of this survey. So I'm jumping immediately to the main outcomes after using this sample enumeration. These are the results for the value of time, transport time in euros per hour in prices of 2010 by mode and by travel purpose. And we find values of around 10 euros per hour for commute, values of around 7 euros per hour for other purposes, but much higher for other purposes, leisure in airplanes. And we find the highest values for business travelers, and especially for a business traveler in the business segment of an airplane, so business class travelers, you might call them maybe. It's not business. No, I know. I know. It's someone traveling for business class. But I thought it was a nice expression to say this is a business class traveler. That has really a very high value. So these are the values of time that we got. This is what we got for reliability. For reliability, I'm expressing now our results in terms of a reliability ratio, which is the coefficient for the standard deviation of travel time divided by the coefficient of travel time. So how important is reliability relative to travel time? And for commuting, we get then a reliability ratio of about 0.4, for other 0.6, maybe 0.7 for air, and the highest one we find for business. For business, it's clearly higher than for the other purposes. So compared to travel time, for business travelers, reliability is important. Then we got a question from ITF. Can you say something about the impact of distance on the value of travel time? Because that's one of the topics of this roundtable. We could have answered that very briefly by saying no, there is no impact. Because trip distance is not in the model. There's no explanatory variable on trip distance in the model. But yeah, we're trying to be a bit more helpful than that. So we said time and cost. They are in the model, they're highly correlated with distance. What is the impact of the time and cost of the reference trip in the SP on the value of travel time? And we did a new analysis. It's not in our report of 2013 or in our article of 2014. This is this was done a few weeks ago. We did this by doing sample enumeration. So we applied the equations that we estimated on people in the sample, and then we grouped the people in the sample by their travel time. And then you get this graph of increasing travel time and what happens then to the value of time by purpose. And we first see that the value of time for commuting increases quite a lot with increasing trip time. Also, the value of time for other increases, but not as much. And the value for business, well, that's not really a pattern. It's almost a straight line. Well, this is time. We did the same for the cost of the reference trip. Then you get this one. And it could have been the same picture. It's very similar. A big increase for commuting, a small increase for other, and no pattern all across for business. That was block one. Now I'm going to say something about productive value of time and this Hensher equation. First, Hensher equation is, of course, called after David Hensher, who is not unknown in these circles. But it seems that David Hensher is not the only father of this equation. There are many people working at the time, late 70s, at ITS Leeds, who seem to have been behind this equation. So it's called the Hensher equation, but it could have been the Tony Fowkes equation or some of these other people working there at the time. And also something I would like to discuss with some people at the other side here of the table, of the round table. Okay, productive travel time and the Hensher equation. Maybe a bit strange, but I'm going to the microeconomic theory now of the consumer, of the employee, not of the employer. But there are a number of similarities between this equation and what the Hensher equation is doing. And I would like to point that out, that the Hensher equation does a number of things that are also in this equation for the time allocation of the consumer. It's the model of the SERPA, which can also be found elsewhere. And it says that the value of time that we use in project appraisal, so the thing we are trying to find, is a difference of two terms. The first term is a ratio of the multiplier, the Lagrangian multiplier of the time constraint. So for instance, there are only 24 hours in a day. You have to stick to that. Divided by the marginal utility of income, because you want to make it a monetary value. And then the second term is the direct utility you get during the trip from doing productive things or useful things during the trip, also made monetary by the marginal utility of income. So the first term is the opportunity cost of travel time. Because you're traveling, you can't be at the origin, you can't be at the destination, so you're losing the utility you could get at the origin or the destination. And the second term is the productive value of travel time. What can you make during the travel time? It's not just wasted time. You might use the travel time for something else. Okay, that the important thing of this equation actually is the minus sign. We've been discussing this idea, but I haven't seen this particular equation yet. If you increase the work during travel, so you do more work during the trip, or you do more productive work during the trip, then the second term goes up, and the value of travel time goes down because of this minus sign. This minus sign is very important. It makes the travel time, it could lead to a zero value of time if the second term becomes big enough. Okay, now the Hensier equation. It asks a number of questions. It has a number of aspects that are also in this theory. It asks, for instance, about this first term, where the time that you gain goes to. Will you spend it working? Will you spend it for leisure? Does it go to the employer or the employee? Another question that is asked by the Hensier equation is how much trip time is spent working? So during the trip, are you working or not? And how productive is working during the trip relative to working at the workplace? So the alpha that Mons was talking about. In our survey, in all three surveys, so in 88, in 97, and 2011, and also in 2009, but I'm not showing that, we asked questions about this to the people traveling for business trips. So I'm only talking about business trips. The things that the Hensier equation needs, we need to populate them, so we need to ask them a few questions. So this was asked from the travelers. First, what is the fraction of the time that you save that would be spent working? So you get an extra hour, the trip time is reduced. What are you going to do? Well, then we get values of around 0.5. So about half of the time that you save would be spent working for business trips. Then who's working during the trip? This is not very reassuring. It's a bit. You may have the impression that those business travelers are working all the time in the trains and such, but this tells a different message. And Marie also said this is self-reported. It might even be worse. Some people here might even have been sleeping. So what do they say? What do the people say? They say that business travelers, that in the car, only 2-3%, 4%. Of the time is spent working. In the train, it's now 16%, but not more than that. And it's not much in bus, tram, and metro, or airplane either. So this is very low. And it's not very different from what you found in the UK. Also, something quite low. Well, I'll come back to this when talking about zero value of time, because this is important for it. And how productive is the work, given that you work? So this is not including whether people will be working, but if they work during the trip, how productive is it? Well, that's not so bad. It's about 0.9 for the train. It's now 0.94. In the airplanes, even 1. And I think it was even above 1. So if you want to be productive, get rid of your colleagues and start flying. So once people start working, they can be almost as productive already as at the workplace. I'll come back to these numbers when talking about zero value of time, but now I move to all trip purposes, so not just business, but all trip purposes. Useful travel time. Because it's not only about that you can work during the trip, you can also do all kind of nice things which give you utility, and utility is not just working, utility can be anything that you like. We asked a number of questions during our survey. We asked this in the 2009-2011 survey, but we also asked these questions already in 97 and 88. And yesterday Marco prepared some additional slides on this, which we might show. They're not part of this presentation, but if somebody wants to know about it, then we'd be happy to show them. And maybe we'll do it anyway. I'm now only talking about the slides that we have for the 2009-2011 survey on these additional questions. And so we asked in our survey, for all purposes, which devices did you have available during the trip? Did you have a mobile phone available, computer, laptop, BlackBerry, music player, etc.? And we asked, could you spend the travel time in the vehicle, could also be the train, usefully, yes or no? So that's about the first term of the ZERPA, the second term of the ZERPA equation, the one with the minus sign. We also asked questions about the first term with a plus sign. Those are the bottom two here. We asked which activity would you have carried out as a respondent if the trip had a shorter duration. So you save some time, what would you have done with the extra time, and would it have been useful? Or reverse, the trip takes longer, you lose some time, which activity are you not carrying out? Or are you reducing in time? And would that be annoying? Well, these are a number of questions that we asked. Originally, in the report for the ministry, we did not use these questions. So we calculated values of time without referring to these questions. But 1-2 years ago, we started thinking, they may be interesting, these questions. Let's add them to the analysis. And we worked on that. And the details are in the paper in the Journal of Choice Modeling. But I'll show you the main results. We estimated a model, and the model looks like this. So what you want to know is the thing in the sort of round table, value of transport time, VTT. And in the model, this was already affected by personal attributes and other trip attributes, could be positive or negative. And then we added to the explanation of the value of transport time, would an alternative activity, if you would gain time, would that be useful? And according to the model of the ZERPA, the influence of that should be positive. Well, we included it, and we found a positive influence. It increases the value of transport time, as it should. Then we tried the second component of the ZERPA equation. Is travel time being spent usefully? Can you spend your travel time? Did you spend your travel time in a useful way? We expect a negative influence, the minus sign, and we got it. So we got a negative influence in line with the model on the value of transport time. And then we thought, what can influence this answer to the question, can you spend your travel time in a useful way? And we thought about computers, laptops, the availability of that. And indeed, we found that having a computer, laptop available has a positive influence on the possibility of spending your travel time in a useful way. And through that, it also influences the value of transport time. Now, these are just pluses and minuses. I can also give the numbers. So what we found is that if travel time would become shorter, and that would be useful, then what does this do for the value of travel time? It increased the value of travel time by about 20%, and this applies to all modes and all purposes. That's the first component. Then the second component with the minus sign, if travel time can be spent in a useful way, then this decreases the value of time by another 20%. It's not the same number, but they're both close to 20%. But this we only find for for train and public transport, and not for car, maybe in the future with automated vehicles, but for the moment, train and public transport, local public transport. And finally, if you have a computer, laptop available during the trip, this reduces your value of travel time through this useful travel time by approximately 2%. And if everybody in our sample would have a computer available during the trip, then this would reduce the value of time by another 1%, so 3% in total. So the impact of a computer on the value of travel time is 3% in total. It's not much, but it's something. Fourth block, the last block, the change in the value of travel time over the years. And now I'm talking about the long term. Some researchers have already been looking into this. How does the value of travel time change over the years? And most of the researchers looked at the income elasticity of the value of travel time. There are several ways of doing it. One of this is doing a meta-analysis, and especially Mark Wortman has been doing many of those. And in the UK, the observed values of the income elasticity of the value of travel time tend to 1. The longer the time series becomes, the more you get towards a value of 1. There is a caveat here, at least this is my caveat. I think in the meta-analysis carried out so far, we have not included all the differences between the different value of time studies, because there have also been changes in the statistical design, and especially in the utility specification, trying to catch the long tail of the travel time distribution that changed the outcomes, which have not been used as attributes of the meta-regression. So maybe this income elasticity that is increasing, it may be picking up something like this also, but we have to test that. The other way of doing this, the other way of finding an income elasticity of the value of travel time, is to do a longitudinal comparison, which means that you're looking at one country at several moments in time, for instance, comparing national value of travel time surveys. Important is that you use the same method, the same estimation method, the same data collection method in both years. It should be a fair comparison. And that's probably the reason why only few of these studies exist, because it's very difficult to make a fair comparison. There was a study by Hugh Gunn, or it was reported by Hugh Gunn in 2001 for the Netherlands. Tepley et al. Looked at this for the UK. Maria Börjesson looked at this for Sweden. I'm talking about the Netherlands now, so I'm focusing now on the results of Hugh Gunn. Hugh Gunn compared the first two Dutch national value of travel time surveys, and he found that over time, the value of travel time grows, but not as much as income grows. And he recommended an income elasticity of the value of time of 0.5. And this is exactly what we're still using in the Netherlands. This is how we escalate our values of time, 0.5. Then the question is, why isn't this one? Shouldn't this be one? And his suggestion was, this has to do with this productive use of travel time. Travel time has become more productive over time, for instance, because of better ICT possibilities. So that's the second component of the SERP equation, which he probably also was thinking about. Hugh Gunn compared study number one and study number two in the Netherlands. We compared study number two and study number three. Some of this was already presented at the Choice Modeling Conference in 2017 in Cape Town, in a presentation together with Maria and Andrew Daly. So for the Netherlands, we're comparing the last study with the one but last study, and what we find is that for many multi-purpose combinations, the real value of travel time, so after correcting for inflation, it goes up. So there is an increase in the value of time, but not as much as income does. So very similar to Yogan. But even stronger, there are some multi-purpose combinations, maybe even more than some, where the real value of travel time goes down over time. So you would then, if income increases, you would have a negative income elasticity. And again, we think this has to do with the second component of the SERP equation, with productive use of travel time and ICT. Finally, are we ever going to a zero value of travel time? Well, I think it's time to put in some caveats here, and I'm going to use citations again for the caveats. The first is, it's very difficult to make predictions, especially about the future. There are many people who are regarded as the original, or as the origin for this citation. I think the best evidence is that it's just a Danish proverb, but we have some Danes here. Who knows? We can also have a discussion about this. It's hard to argue against this one, but the second one I think is probably deeper, and I very much agree with it. That was made by Henri Poincaré, a French mathematician, and he said it's far better to foresee even without certainty than not to foresee at all. So let's acknowledge uncertainty, but still try to do forecasting. Okay, here we go. We've seen in the tables that I showed about the business travelers and the Henschel equation that partly because of ICT developments, working in the train is almost as productive as working at the workplace. You've now got a factor of 0.94 if you work. What about a car? Well, automated vehicles could also make this possible in the car, if people would have automated vehicles and would go for it everywhere. And working in a car, an automated vehicle, might even be better than working in a train. It would be quieter, probably. It would probably not be crowded. It could even be better than the workplace. So let's never leave the automated vehicle. But another requirement to go to a very low or zero value of time is that we work all the time, or at least we work as much as we do elsewhere, as we would do at the origin destination, at the workplace, say. And that's not what we see. We see that the business travelers, only a rather small fraction of them, only the train that is, it's much smaller even for the other modes, is working. And that's maybe disappointing for the people who want to go to zero value of time, but that's what we see. And why is that? Why are business travelers not working so much? Well, a lot of business travel, of course, takes place in the early morning and the evening and the night, and people may regard this as their own time. But it also has to do with the fact that some time just cannot be converted into productive time. You have to find a seat. You may have to stand because it's crowded. You just can't do any serious work. And in the end, it's a choice. It's a choice that people make. People make a choice whether to work or not while traveling. And I don't see reasons why this would change over time very much. There might be reasons, but I don't see them. So, if they don't work, they might be doing something else which is productive, but the values for that are not as high as for working, so that will also not help very much. So the only thing that could bring us to zero value of time is large changes in how we spend our travel time. Or that's probably almost the only thing that can give us there, and I don't see why this would happen. So I don't think we're going to a zero or even a very low value of travel time. On the other hand, I think it's quite likely that the value of travel time will not increase as much as income, because we've already seen that in the past. And there are all kinds of technological developments and societal developments that seem to be going on. It's not unlikely even that value of time will decline over time in real terms, as we've already seen for some mode and purpose combinations. So it may go down, the value of time, or it may not go up very much. So I think the least we can do is to reconsider our escalation factors, the factors that we now use in cost-benefit analysis to calculate future values of time from the reference values of time, from the values of time of the base year. In the Netherlands, we use this income elasticity of 0.5. Other countries use an income elasticity of 1. This is really blowing up the values of time of the future, and this may not be the right thing to do. So, something to reconsider, I think. And that ends my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.